meeting them tonight for the first time this season, but hoping to extend their victory streak over the Penguins to 8 games. Was an easy game for the LaFontaine-led Islanders. He makes it 1-0 when he deflects Denny Potvin's slap shot into the net in the first period, and then it was 2-0 in the second when Mikko Mikkala made it 3-0. He gets the rebound in close and beats Joe Melosh there. And then Brian Trottier probably put it completely out of reach and had Pittsburgh thinking about tomorrow night when he scores here on the power play. Just the easy, and nobody takes him out front, and it's 4-0 Islanders. Meanwhile, at the other end, Kelly Rudy played tremendously in net for the Islanders. One of 30 saves here, stopping the big rookie, Mario Lemieux, who had almost an empty net until Rudy slid over on the pass.
Making the fourth stop on a 5-game road trip, the Checkerdome, an unfriendly spot for the Jersey team. They lost.
Rich Cron, tied up by Buskus, Krache and Duguay bumping. Bossy moves the puck along the boards. Now back to the point for Conroy. Into Richard Cron, in front to Conroy. The shot tipped in. Bossy deflecting it. The Islanders win it in overtime, 4-3. They come flooding off the bench to congratulate. I believe Mike Bossy forced him to change direction. Now Bill Smith and Kelly Rudy skate the length of the ice as Bob Barrett.
Mike Bossy, 2 goals, and the Islanders win it. Bossy's first one coming right here, and his second goal later on made it 4-2. The Islanders over the North Stars, final score 5-3. And the Devils come.
Pittsburgh shot deflected in by Dirk Graham. Minnesota led by a score of 1-0. But third, and it was 1-1. A great bit of passing, Gilbert to Trottier to Bossy. And look at this one. The Islanders, beautiful shot. Gord Dineen from Bossy, a terrific shot that time. That made
it. It's Dennis Potvin setting up Bossy for his 26th. What a quick wrist shot by him. Fastest gun in the East, West, or anywhere. It is 4-2 Islanders. They cap a 3-goal second period explosion, dragging it off the boards. Perfect setup for Trottier. That time from Bossy, he set up 2 goals, scored a couple, and the Islanders easy over the North Stars.
In hockey, the Islanders hosted Pittsburgh. This man is incredible. Michael Bossy with his 28th goal of the year, later scores his 29th goal of the year. Look at the follow-up. But all the Islanders got was a 3-3 tie with the Penguins in spite of great goaltending by Billy Smith and Bossy's 28th and 29th goals of the year. The final five. They couldn't clear the puck out of their own end. Gaetan Duchesne tips one past Rudy on one occasion. That made it 2-1 in favor of Washington. Now with the score tied at 2, look at Duchesne in front. They couldn't keep him out of there. 3-2 the final score. Kerr and Sutter scored, Brent Sutter, for the Islanders. But
period, 2-1 Flyers are leading. Brian Trottier to Mike Bossy to Richard Cron in front, who scores, beats Chico Resch to tie the game at 2. But there was all Flyers as Tim Kerr from Eklund on the power play. Timmy Kerr, the power play specialist. The Flyers grab a 3-2 lead. Then watch from behind the net, Pelle Eklund, Doug Crossman at the point to Murray Craven. And Craven skates in and scores on the backhand, a controversial goal. Billy Smith feeling that there was some action in the crease that there shouldn't have been, but the goal stands, and the Flyers beat the New York Islanders.
Canada, and a big game for both teams. They're trying to make the playoffs. Both teams still in the hunt for the playoffs. Here's Gastron Gingrask with a blast from the near side, 1-0 Montreal in the second period. And here's a creative way to score a goal. What you do is you pin the opposing goalie down, and then you let your buddy score. Montreal led 2-0 at that point. They go on to win it by a 3-0 final up in Canada. And finally tonight, something for John.
Battling back against the very hot Detroit Red Wings, whose resident goon, Bob Probert, got into it with Brian Curran. Down 2-1, third period. The Islanders come on. Mikko Mäkelä to Brian Trottier. His shot bounces free behind Greg Stephan. It sits there till Trottier finishes it off. That ties it at 2, and with seconds to play, Pat LaFontaine skates in. fires home the winner. Second place Isles now lead the Rangers by 4 points going into Saturday's showdown. 8 games to play for each team. A couple of other NHL finals tonight. Philly somewhat surprising.
The Rangers 4-3. The Islanders up their advantage over the Rangers now to 6 points. The Rangers also stay in fourth place. There's still a point back at the Capitals in fourth place. Let's pick it up in the first period. Score was tied at one. Pat LaFontaine to Mikko Mäkelä, then a nice feed of the charging Ari Hanpa, scoring past John Van Beesbrook, 2-1 Islanders. And they were hitting tonight. Watch this. Thomas Sandstrom just sends Dwayne Sutter reeling to the ice with a shot, and then later Bob Bassan puts a shot to Marcel Dion along the boards. Then Alan Kerr becomes the recipient of a shot on the boards, and when Kerr tries to get up from this one, he gets another hit, this time from his own man, Brian Curran. Another routine night of Rangers-Islanders hockey. From there, we take you late in the second. Ron Greschner, beautiful move around Mike Bossy. Using Randy Boyd as a screen, he beats Haruti. It was 3-2 Rangers after two. But here in the third, back-to-back goals from Pat LaFontaine was a difference. He had won the face-off, then off the shot by Ken Leiter. He gets it past Van Beesbrook. Hey, the Islanders win it 4-3 over the Rangers tonight. Elsewhere, tuned.
Just handle it. Mikko Mäkelä could have shot, but he saw Pat LaFontaine standing off to the side. LaFontaine took it in his skate, stopped it, and then hammered it into the...
Islanders have done it. They have beaten Washington 5-4 to force the seventh game Saturday night in Landover. Trailing 3-2, second period. Pat LaFontaine on the power play in front. That tied it 3-3. And just 3 minutes later, here they come. LaFontaine sets up Mäkelä. That makes it 4-3 Islanders on a pretty goal. And 2 minutes later, it's Mäkelä returning the favor. Sets up LaFontaine 5-3. They win it 5-4. Moments ago, Sal Marciano talked with LaFontaine.
The crowd would stand and encourage him with an ovation.
Games too, but right now they're leading in the third period on a goal courtesy of Brian Trottier. Gord Denine fires from the left circle, but Trottier is there for the rebound as the Isles right now lead 5-4 in the third period.
Play, Gord Denine's drive from the point is stopped by Bob Mason. Brian Trottier backhands the rebound into the net. 1-0 New York. Just over a minute left in the first now. Bob Bassan's drive stopped by Mason, but Dwayne Sutter knocks home the rebound. 2-0 Isle after one. Washington stormed back, though, with 3 goals in the second period. The third came on a power play. Pavanka, Mikhail sets it up. Kastelic in front. Kastelic beats Rudy. 3-2 Caps. Now, back home. Here come the Islanders on the power play. Mikko Mäkelä gets the puck over to Pat LaFontaine, and he scores. It's 3-3. Then the Isles regain the lead. Pat LaFontaine springs Mikko Mäkelä for the breakaway, and he'll score on the backhand, 4-3 New York.
All right, thank you very much, Gail Gardner. It is 2-2. Obviously, we're getting set for the fourth overtime right now. This game is the seventh longest in National Hockey League history. If it goes 10 minutes, 19 seconds longer, it will become the third longest game in National Hockey League history. Need we say more? Let's go live back to the Capitol Center. Mike Emmerich and Bill Clement, gentlemen, my congratulations on a great call and a long night's work. You've hung in there just like the players. What do you expect? Is it fair to ask you what you expect, Bill, in this overtime?
Gosh, who knows what to expect now, Tom? I know one thing. Mike Emmerich's arm has gotten so tired and his ear is so tired that I am wearing the piece that allows me to hear you, and I'm also holding the mic. And if anybody's wondering how long we...
Channel number one in New York sports.
That was some pass that set up that goal.
Yeah, lucky for us, Bob Warren was skating on his toes. In every play, there's one key man the whole team depends on.
And he's got to be ready to take care of his teammates on and off the ice. Hey, where is our designated driver anyhow?
Over here, fellas. Tonight I'm looking out for my teammates and driving them home. No alcohol for me.
Yeah, you can say he's the life of the party.
Governor Cuomo's Athletes Against Drunk Driving team wants you to be the life of your party. Be a designated driver, stay sober, and drive your friends home. Be the key player everyone can depend on.
We've already seen that 1986 was a pretty good year for New York's local baseball teams, but how about the area's three hockey teams? For a look at how the Islanders, Devils, and Rangers fared in 1986, here's Sports Channel's Stan Fischler.
For the New York Islanders, 1986 opened with a bang. January 2nd was Denny Potvin night at Nassau Coliseum, as the Isles took on the Boston Bruins. Coach Al Arbuskate has not only responded with a 7-5 victory, but super scorer Mike Bossy produced his 500th NHL goal. Just a week later, Long Island fans had a good look at their goalie of the future, Kelly Rudy. The heir apparent to Bill Smith stopped the Pittsburgh Penguins cold as the Islanders produced a 9-0 triumph. The best team in the Patrick Division last season was the Philadelphia Flyers. But even the Broad Street Bullies got their comeuppance in Uniondale. On January 21st and again on January 30th, the Isles slapped down the Flyers by successive 7-3 and 8-4 scores. Mike Bossy has never played an NHL season in which he scored less than 50 goals, and 1985-86 was no exception. He beat goalies from every angle, and on February 16th, he scored a 3-goal hat trick, his 35th career hat trick, en route to a 6-5 win over the New Jersey Devils. The Islanders approached the home stretch at a good clip. On March 4th, they played the eventual Stanley Cup-winning Montreal Canadiens. And with the energy supplied by young Pat LaFontaine, they routed the Flying Frenchman 6-3. One of the most emotional days and nights in Islander history occurred on March 11th, when the club traded veteran John Tinelli to the Calgary Flames for Steve Conroy and Richard Crum. By an amazing coincidence, the Flames were scheduled to play the Islanders at Nassau Coliseum that night. Adding to the drama was the fact that Mike Bossy scored 4 goals, leading the Isles to an 8-4 victory in which Richard Crum played a leading part. The Mike Bossy scoring parade continued through March. On the 20th, the Isles visited storied Maple Leaf Gardens in Toronto, where the Bars scored hat trick number 37. The Nassau Skaters rolled to a 7-1 victory. Unfortunately for the Islanders, the 1985-86 season concluded on a less than happy note. Although they finished solidly entrenched in third place, their first-round challenge against the second-place Washington Capitals fizzled from the start, and they were eliminated from the playoffs in 3 straight games. The summer of 1986 was among the most meaningful in Islander history. After 13 years as coach, the distinguished Al Arbour decided to call it a coaching career. At a Nassau Coliseum press conference, he announced his retirement and soon was succeeded by the gifted Terry Simpson, who immediately made a positive impression on metropolitan area hockey fans. Several Islander players marveled at the ease of transition from Arbour to Simpson. After a somewhat slow start, the Isles got their act together, and by mid-November were in the thick of the Patrick Division race. Undoubtedly the most stirring win, and one of the most thrilling in the club's history, took place on November 18th at the Colisée in Quebec. Trailing the Nordiques, the Isles rallied to tie the count on Brian Trottier's goal with only 1 second left in the third period. Then, when it appeared that time was running out in sudden death overtime, Mike Bossy took a pass from Trottier and annexed the game with the winning goal. It was apparent from the start of the 1986-87 season that the race for Patrick Division playoff berths would produce a dogfight more intense than anything the NHL has known. The Devils, Rangers, Capitals, and Flyers all looked like potential threats, but the Penguins, led by the incomparable Mario Lemieux, posed a special challenge to the Islanders. Back-to-back games, first on November 25th at Nassau and then November 26th at Pittsburgh, the Islanders topped Mario sextet and served notice on the rest of the Patrick Division that they meant business. The senior member of the team, Captain Denny Potvin, demonstrated that he has lost none of his defensive nor offensive skills. Typical of the Potvin anticipation was a movie made on December 5th at Pacific Coliseum. The score tied late in the third period, Potvin streaked in from the blue line, accepted a radar-like pass from Mikko Makkola, and scored the winning goal past Frank Caprice of the Vancouver Canucks. As the playoff race tightened in December, the Isles were twice challenged by the Devils. Terry Simpson's Skaters took the opener of a back-to-back series by thrashing the Devils at Byrne Arena. The tension generated by the rivalry was evident at game's end when a full-scale brawl erupted. The teams concentrated on hockey when they met again at Nassau, but the Isles once again prevailed. Lacking his usual sharpness early in the season, clutch goalie Bill Smith regained his form in dramatic fashion against the Minnesota North Stars on December 16th. Diving, sprawling, and kicking out innumerable shots, Smitty held back the visitors for a key 4-2 Islanders win at the Coliseum.
Comeback goal of Philadelphia. 1 second is left, and now Don Koharski may have hoped that that one would have gone off because Dave Brown and Marty McSorley seem willing. Turned back along by Leiter. Langway in the race with Bassett. Langway overskates, so does Bassett.
First hockey game since then, he has gotten stronger.
Personification of fatigue. You saw at the bench as Duchesne moves on. They try the angle play again. Rudy has a little trouble, but is able to quickly wrist it away. Wood advances it to Makala. And Makala, defended by Rod Langway, so that play breaks down. With it is Ken Morrow moving back. And Morrow gave it up to Duchesne. Duchesne starting back in. Drive and getting the stick on that was Rudy. It's chipped back off by LaFontaine and guided out by Makala. They try to work further. Going ahead is Wood. Leaned on, wedged by Murphy, but he got a pass in front that Rod Langway takes over. Angles it back off for Christian. Chucks it ahead. Gartner moving in with Gould. Oh. Over to Gould, and the pass too stiff for him to take. Then Gould flips one. That is lost momentarily.
Shot to the pass, and he overpassed. He passed it too hard. Watch here. Fake the shot. Now with the pass, he doesn't take enough steam off of it, and it bounces right off Bobby Gould's stick.
Conroy again flips it back out with the long reach in the glove. Hatcher prevails. Islanders are able to force play back to the neutral zone, and then Stevens deflexes it the other way. Here's a chance as Gartner has a man in the slot, and Christian with a shot. Oh, and that one just wide, and maybe getting a piece of it was Rudy. Flatly floating it in. Christian goes back for the Capitals. Scott Stevens is there, pulls away from Flatly, and it's along to Gartner. Can't clear out. Leiter keeps. Hurries it along. It's off Trotche. Flatly for Trotche, but Scott Stevens right there. It is Mike Gartner playing for the Capitals and sailing one over the reach of Leiter all the way down. 3:30 to go. Third overtime period. Game knotted at two. Langway for Jensen, who's shouldered out of the play by Diddick. And it is Alan Kerr side by side. Missed signals with Bassett, and so Francis Getty comes in. It kicks for Kerr. Oh, and Langway just takes him to the board. Bassin there battling with Langway and Kerr. Dwayne Sutter has it. Fighting with Francis Getty. Puck loose, Alan Kerr around in front. Can't force it home. And holding it to the side of the net is Bob Mason.
It's going to happen with the young legs for one of these teams. They're the only ones with anything left. Alan Kerr that time dancing around. Cut under the chin. Perhaps not beyond pain in the physical sense, and they might acknowledge it in the mental sense. Christian, perhaps use your instincts. Hope that your instincts come through. Don't think about too much. Instincts.
71, two of them. Maybe it'll be the 123rd that will end it, or maybe we'll go into the 200 range.
I can't even fathom that.
Beleaguered. Gould moving in for the faceoff with LaFontaine. And John D'Amico, ever concerned about getting them lined up. Did you notice that? And from the faceoff, it's controlled back to Conroy. His shot is deflected, and Bobby Gould just plays it safely back out. The final minute now of the third overtime. Mason sees that one bounce off his net, but Scott Stevens there. Angled off for Duchesne. Conroy locks up with him. It's forced by Makala. On for Wood. He's given a stiff shoulder by Scott Stevens. And then boomed by Blum. Loose puck. Carried away now by Bobby Gould. Gives it over to Christian. Has Duchesne up the wing. Lays it off for Gould. Here's a chance with Duchesne open. It's rolled in front off Rudy. And able to force it back away with Ken Leiter on defense. Half a minute to go. Third overtime. On with it comes Makala. Moving in. Drive.
Oh,
Mason. Loose puck in front.
and it's gotten by LaFontaine, tripped up, puck came loose to Francis Geddy.
Mike, I think that one hit the handle of Bob Mason's stick. Look at this, here he is.
Francis Geddy, by, save, net dislodged.
Oh.
Rudy made the play, and the force of Francis Geddy going in caused the net to dislodge, and Francis Geddy is down hurt. With 12 seconds left in the third.
Play like that. He has no energy. Yes, he does have energy. We're sitting here, we're saying they have no energy. Look at Francis Geddy. He still has the drive in the legs, but he gets taken down. Does he get the shot away? You betcha. Look at the angle that he is lying in the ice, and he gets his shot away, crashes into the net. Look, he's still going for it.
12 seconds to go. And it is Alan Kerr with one of the last chances of this overtime. Dishes that one off, and here's Crom moving in, forced to the corner by Gartner. The horn sounds. 120 minutes have been played. 126 shots have been taken. 122 saves have been made. And for those of you who've been waiting and hoping that there was another overtime played so that you could see the model quality chest of Phil Clement, you'll get your wish. End of three. Time, Islanders and Washington still tied at two. Trottier tied it up with about 5.5 minutes to go in the third period of regulation. That's where we stand. We'll be by with a SportsCenter update in a moment.
And John DeMeco obviously just
could be a walk for Philadelphia. I don't know how they can recover.
Larry Murphy with a pass. Mike Gartner in. And Gartner moving further. Gartner centered one across the goal mouth wide. We had to double clutch there for a second as fans were stepping by us here to get to their seats. On now comes Mäkelä. Turned over now to Randy Wood. Drive. Oh, and that one whistled wide. Behind the net, it's Mäkelä. Out in front, LaFontaine. Oh. That scramble in front. Oh, and he fought it away again, Bob Mason. Incredible. And one of the best Islander attacks in the last 2.5 or so hours in this game. Conroy keeps. Drive. That one went off Larry Murphy. Now Mike Gartner moves it back out, has Gould along with him. The pass sails through him, and the whole play winds up going offside. But he's got a man in front, Kelly Miller, but he wheels the net himself. Chased all the way by Crom, and it's Trottier for the Islanders. Banks it off for Crom, but Rod Langway there to turn it back the other way. Christian guiding it in. Ken Morrow flops it back, and the tandem of Langway and Hatcher are down.
1933-1936. Keep in mind, only acted pretty well to overtime, didn't he?
Not too bad. Morrow wedges his man off. That's Greg Adams. Still won't let him get to the puck. Adams muscled it a little ways, but now it's Basson starting back out. He's got Dwayne Sutter with him. And Gilbert trying to move up the far side. It is Basson. Checked off, though, by Larry Murphy. Wraps it around. Puck kept by Janssen. Flipped it in front. Still they try to reach it, and on with it now. Pavanka one on two. Pavanka moving in with a wrist shot high off Rudy, and he'll hang on.
As this
action tonight, anything we say
tonight, at the age of 29, he's hung in there with the kids.
Dineen poked it deep. Gould drives it around. Conroy hit hard by Miller. Drive by Wood, and that's off his gate wide. John Blum to play on defense. Can't connect with Francis Geddy, but checks his man Mäkelä. Rod Langway forces it further. Randy Wood able to lay it off. And the Caps having a little trouble deep in their own zone. But it is Gould controlling now and drifting out for the Capitals. Hammers one along, but that caught him.
Yep, we are actually in as far as, and we're not even counting. Other overtime games in this series?
None.
None? We don't have.
Gould one. And it is, again, Randy Boyd this time on defense to play. Crom with a little flip out to Trottier. Cross ice pass, but that one went off Flatley, and Flatley just bumped out of the way by Scott Stevens, but continues to pursue. Martin goes down on the lean of Flatley. Puck loose, shot by Crom, and that well off the mark. Boyd pinches in deep. Boyd behind. Puck turned back out, and with it is Crom. Crom controls, drives one, and that one went right into Scott Stevens.
What a block by Scott Stevens.
And the pass goes by Duchesne. Fourth overtime, still sacrificing himself. Icing.
Leave and come back onto the ice, the entrance or exit. Sorry, standing down. David Poyle, that's him. You can just see his head up in the top row.
And it is Murphy and Langway on, and Langway moves it on to Pavonka. Pavonka up the wing now to Greg Adams. Watching him is Morrow. Adams with a pass in front, and Jensen goes down. Back through now comes Bob Basson, but the net was dislodged.
Close, but that one took a very fast.
Janssen has it. And again, chasing will be Larry Murphy. Murphy with a little pass, circle to circle to Langway. Back through they come. Shoulder applied by Basson, and down goes Greg Adams. Back through with it comes Langway. Has a man breaking and fires one into the pad of Rudy. Murphy controlling. Flipped one in front. That one cut off by Thomas Janssen. And along with it is Adams. Adams over to Pavonka for a drive off the mark. Keeping it is Langway. Throws one in front. That ricocheted off Pavonka. Adams centers one in front. Oh, and a chop made by Pavonka. Couldn't get a shot away as he was tightly checked by Thomas Janssen. Dwayne Sutter with a drive off Langway. And then the back of the goal, and Dwayne Sutter, the first one there. Centers one to the slot. Conroy with a pass in front, unable to take it, was Kerr as it was off his skate. And then down goes Gartner. It's LaFontaine with a shot. Scramble in front. And that one blocked away. Did that get all the way through to Mason?
I'm not sure, Mike.
Pass is on the money to Gartner. One back, back. Conroy jump. Oh, and Rudy able to get it. Dumped along. LaFontaine presses further. Gets some help from Conroy on defense. Wraps it along to Kerr. Fourth overtime, 13-10 to go. LaFontaine ahead, but Kerr just couldn't get loose. Away from Scott Stevens to play it to him. Now on LaFontaine. Shovels it to an empty wing. John Blum hurries to Gartner. Shift change on Islanders. Gartner couldn't crank it. LaFontaine, brilliant checking from behind. Blum able to hold. Gives it for Christian, but Pat flatly in the way. And flatly sails one across that Mackala will have. Set up now for Diddick. Moves in, chops one. That went into Blum. They finesse it over to Mackala. Drives it behind. Flatley is there. Feeds it to the back. Boyd a drive, and getting his stick on it was Gould. Turnaround drive. Snare, drop, trap by Mason.
Can't blame you, son. It's been an exciting hockey game, but it's past your bedtime. Just about 2 o'clock here in D.C.
I'm sure your father will save the ticket. From this face-off, the Islanders have it, but Larry Murphy turns it back along for Stevens. Hooks it Trotje. Trotje again punished by Stevens. And it is Pavonka trying to guide it behind. They want to get a play made back the other way. Work it up the boards or something, but it squirts loose. Puck played by Krom. Couldn't connect with Trotje in front. Gould couldn't follow it up, but now gets help from Pavonka on the play, and they get it back out to the neutral zone. Trotje, bouncer! Oh, and those can be a problem, but Bob Mason was there, and it wouldn't have counted.
Honestly, these players are running on empty and have been for some time, yet they continue to show great perseverance, great determination, great instincts, great hitting, great physical play.
Oh, and just so close there, Dwayne Sutter might have had it, but it's over for Larry Murphy, and Sutter just carries him off firmly. Now Jensen muscling along, able to free it to Pavonka, hands back to Scott Stevens, then along to Greg Adams, and Adams hammers one around that swirls back all the way to center ice. Dwayne Sutter, and it's on Leiter. Leiter moving in. Chopped at by Hatcher. Centers one in front, and just by Langway. Here's Dineen pinching. Looks it over. Dineen gets behind the net. Turns out in front. Shot blocked off by Hatcher. Turnaround. LaFontaine score! Pat LaFontaine! 3-2 Islanders.
Dale Henry might have gotten a piece of it, but what can we say? We will now let the cameras do the talking for us for a moment. Here's a look at it.
Scored by Pat LaFontaine.
It definitely went off someone. At least from where we were sitting, it went off someone.
And Ken Leiter.
Pretty tough to tell on that pan, but you know Bob Mason sensed it immediately. It went behind him. What a play by Gord Dineen. He made the whole thing happen. LaFontaine turning.
The game's third star.
Mason handcuffed. In the fourth longest overtime game in NHL history.
Kelly Rudy. And the game's number one star, Pat LaFontaine.
And the winning goal was standing on its edge when the stick was applied to it.
Ceremonial call. Ceremonial handshake.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
I can only say, gentlemen, and I'm talking about all of the players on the ice, and I think I can use the term literally when I call them all gentlemen. Thank you. It's been an honor to be here.
The least improved team in the NHL this year, Washington, which lost 21 points over last year. And they were forced into a situation here as LaFontaine shaking hands with Lou Franceschetti, where they had their backs to the wall. The Islanders came charging back. Neither team yielding throughout the extra time. One additional full game played.
Since going back and forth and condolences going back and forth. There's Kelly Rudy, who has played one of the most unbelievable hockey games in the history of the National Hockey League.
Wonderful game. 75 shots for the Washington Capitals, 57 for the Islanders, and it ends very close to 2 a.m. Back to Tom Meese.
Game one Monday night at the Spectrum in Philadelphia, and our next game will come your way Monday night as well. Mike and Bill will be up at the Forum in Montreal. Game one between the Quebec.
Levels Pat Flatley of the Islanders, but Flatley says, don't worry about it. I will score a goal. And he ties it at one of the second period. Later on in the second period, loose puck behind the net. Grant Martin bumps Randy Boyd off the play, walks in front, and just more than a minute to go in the second period of regulation, it was 2-1 Caps in the third period. About 6 minutes to go, Brian Trottier skates in and backhander beats Bob Mason. We are tied at two, move into overtime. First overtime and throughout, the goalies scintillating. Kelly Miller to Bob Gould. Rudy with the save, and he holds on. Kelly Rudy on the night, unbelievable. But not to be outdone at the other end. Bob Mason to the Caps. Thomas Jensen to Bob Batson. But Mason holds on. We move to the second overtime. The Caps carrying the play. Bob Gould breaks it. Rudy with a save. Wants to drop it. Oh, no. It's in front. Save again. Rebound in front. The Islanders try and clear. They put another shot on. We go to the third, then the fourth overtime. Finally, the call.
Here's Dineen pinching, looks it over. Dineen gets behind the net, turns out in front, shot blocked off by Hatcher. Turnaround, LaFontaine, score! Pat LaFontaine!
47 of the fourth overtime, the fifth longest game in NHL history. LaFontaine from Dineen and Ken Leiter, and the Islanders beat the Caps 3-2 in a game that saw Kelly Rudy make 73 saves tonight, and Bob Mason with 54 saves. And what can you say? We had that feeling that it would never end.
I tell you, you talked about watching it on TV, but talk about being there as well. And two gentlemen who were there, and boy, were they there, Mike Emmert and Bill Clement. Gentlemen.
If you love hockey, you'll put this in the same category as where you were when the first man made his stride onto the moon, because this was sensational tonight. Bill?
What can you say? A spectacle of epic proportion, but we have to keep in mind it's only a sporting event, and in watching it, now that it's over, I have to wonder, and I'm reasonably new to the sportscasting industry, I have to wonder if I haven't seen the most unbelievable thing I'm ever going to see. It had absolutely everything, and I hope that's not the most unbelievable thing I've ever seen, but if it is, it was well worth it. What an outstanding, unbelievable sight, period after period. And I'm trying not to overstate it. It meant that much to me. I'm drained. I was on the edge of my seat the entire game, and it really meant something to me to be here tonight, Mike.
Not all, but it's just a marvelous thing to be a part of. 18,130 here, all of you people as well, and we're just pleased to have been a part of it, to bring it to you, and we hope you thoroughly enjoyed what you've seen tonight.
I can only feel for the Washington Capitals. Right now, my thoughts are in the Washington Capitals room, who could have won this game in the first period, second, third, fourth, fifth, or sixth, and never did. They played an unbelievable hockey game, and unfortunately for them, they had to see their season end. I almost wish this was the sixth game of their series against the Islanders instead of the seventh game. But somebody had to win. Someone had to lose. Let's not take anything away from the young legs of the New York Islanders and first-year coach Terry.
Three in the third and beat Edmonton 5-3, so they cut the lead to 2-1. Let's go to the videotape. It's 3-3, third period. Scott Mellenby. Nice pass to Brad McCrimmon. McCrimmon beats Fuhrer to make it 4-3 Flyers. Then, 30 seconds left in the game, the open net, Brian Propp, give me that goal. He's got it, 5-3, Flyers win it, game four, Sunday night in Philadelphia.
2-0 in games and 2-0 in this game. On the Oiler power play, Glenn Anderson fans on the shot, but it skids under Ron Hextall. Oilers 3-0 appeared in command, but the Flyers scored 4 unanswered goals at home. 3-3 in the third, Ron Sutter to Scott Mellenby, there to Brad McCrimmon, and they take the lead in the game, win it 5-3.
One of the late Kate Smith singing the national anthem when she used to. They used to win all the time, it seemed. And early on, though, it wasn't good because Mark Messier got a breakaway on shorthanded, went in on Hextall and beat him on the backhand to make it 1-0 Oilers early. Hextall then got a flurry of saves in this situation, but watch very closely. The puck will bounce into the net just over the line. They called that a goal, and with 9 seconds to go in the first period, it was 2-0 Edmonton, and that looked like a rally killer. Edmonton made it 3-0, but the Flyers rallied again and tied it up at 3 when Scott Mellenby shot one that went between the pads of Grant Fuhr, and the rally was on. The Flyers went ahead as Mellenby passed it perfectly to Brad McCrimmon out front, who tipped it home. It was 4-3. The goals were only 17 seconds apart, and the Flyers had rallied from a 3-0 deficit.